Nice to see everybody today. Whether you're here or joining us online, good morning. Just awesome to be in the house of the Lord again. Man, you should love the Lord. You should love Yahweh with all of your heart, with all of your soul, with all of your might. I will give you, Lord, all of my heart. Lord, I'll give you all my soul. I'll grant you all of my strength, Father, because you are the world to me. Please join me for the opening hymn. Please stand. Acknowledge you, Lord, as the righteous, great and righteous King of heaven. Great, you are the great, all-knowing one. You are the all-wise one, Father. We adore and love you, Father, because you love us before we were even aware of our existence, Lord. What a great love that is beyond our understanding sometimes. Master, help us all to walk in a manner that's worthy of children of God in a country and a world that so desperately needs you and the message of the gospel, and in a world and a country that so desperately needs the example of your children, us. Master, as we come together for fellowship, let your will be done. Let your will be done, not ours. We ask for an increasing, Master, of our knowledge of you. We ask for an increasing, Master, daily of our spiritual wisdom, our spiritual understanding of you, of your word, of our example, King Jesus. Let those things, Master, continually increase as we constantly, Father, seek you from a sincere heart. We seek you, Father, in an awesome kingdom where humility and love rules the day. Great King of Heaven, we want your name to be magnified today as we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. And a hymn, God Bless America. Feel free to turn around and wave, or you know, say do what you will. Yeah, looks like we're ready for our announcements.
Are they going to be up there?
Yes. There you go.
I just want to make sure, and I think that most of you do understand the meeting that is scheduled for next Sunday right after church. We are not voting on a minister, because you have to hear the minister preach before we take a vote on the minister. This is only to see if you're in agreement with what's in the letter that's been emailed out. Some have been mailed by postal services. Be sure and check your emails and your mail, your daily mail. If you don't receive it before next Sunday, before next Friday or so, leave a message with the answering machine at the church, and we'll see that you get it. So, okay, just wanted to make sure we're clear on that with everyone. We're just voting if you're in favor of a part-time as well as a full-time pastor. And then, of course, the women's meeting canceled. They're predicting 90-plus degrees, and we don't think we want be out in that on that Thursday. As for with the current surge of the virus, we're considering taking everyone's temperature. Yeah. Would you hand me that? I'm sorry. I did. Now I've contaminated you. We do have one of these available to take temperatures with. We don't want to infringe on anyone and make them angry, so we're asking if you would be in favor of having your temperature taken as you come to church. Raise your hands if you would be. Looks like this group is unanimous with it then. Okay. And there's an announcement there. The city Emma. You're considering Sunday school and childcare. And Eric also asked if you have a favorite hymn or a praise song to let him know. Also, they had the prayer list, and Teddy's name was taken off because we thought she was well. Unfortunately, she is not. The diverticulosis has returned. Diverticuli, I think, is the way they pronounce what she has. And they've started some couple of very strong antibiotics. Started the day before yesterday, so she doesn't know yet. She's not feeling better yet. She's in a lot of pain right now, so keep her in mind. Make sure I don't let anything else here. I believe that's all the announcements that I have. Thank you.
I should mention about the praise songs. There is a little caveat to it. We just want to be careful with the licensing, so there's a possibility that we might not be able to do something at your request, but definitely will try my best. So. All right, so next I'm going to have another praise song, How Deep the Father's Love for Us. Please stand.
Beyond all measure, that he should give his only son to make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing loss! The father turned his face away. As wounds which father chosen for bring many sons to glory. Behold a man upon a cross, my sin upon his shoulders. Ashamed I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished. Reward. I cannot give an answer, this I know with all my heart. His wounds have made my ransom.
Conceal them from their children, but tell the generation to come the praises of Yahweh and his strength and his wondrous words that he has done. Psalm 78, amen. Please join me for a word of prayer before the pastor comes. Oh, great God of heaven, again, we are so thankful, Father, to have come together again. It's so nice to be together and to sing together and enjoy the presence of the Holy Spirit in this place, the presence of the Holy Spirit on the inside of us. Oh, hallelujah, to your name, Father, we love you so much. Thank you for being with us throughout the week. Thank you for walking with us. Thank you for all of the ways that you've touched others in this community and around the city through us, your children, Father. We pray as always, Father, for more workers in the vineyard, because we know that the enemy is working, so we must be working. Help us, Master, individually to always put a premium on our individual relationships with you. It's following you, Lord, we know is so much more important than listening to the damaging messages in this world, Father. As the great Apostle Paul said, your servant, follow me as I follow Christ. Father, help us to be an example to the world of how to follow the Lord and the awesome transformation of power of your salvation. Lord, my heart breaks to see how people treat each other in this world. And all the biases and stereotypes that we throw at each other. But help us, Lord, the church, to be different. Because we know that things are done so differently in your kingdom. Help us, Lord, to have a mindset that is appropriate to people who are following Christ. The mind of Christ, Lord. We need the mind of Christ. So that people will see us again and glorify your name in heaven, Father. That your name will be magnified in the earth. Help us, Lord, to put our confidence in you. Always, Father. No matter what gets thrown at us, we know that we can trust you. We know we can trust your healing power, Father. Remember those, Master, on the prayer list. In the name of Jesus, Father, we pray that you remember Peg, Father, that she's in pain right now, Lord. We know, Master, that you have a heart for the suffering, a huge heart for the suffering. Lord, so I pray, Master, that you would touch her, Father. Sit with her. Comfort her, Holy Spirit. That your healing power be at work right now, Father, in her life, in Jesus' name. Help us, Lord, to be blessed, our children, your children, to be blessed with the knowledge of your will, Lord. Help us to know your will as we make decisions regarding the future of this ministry. Help us to have wisdom and knowledge and walk in a manner worthy of the calling that you've given us, Father, at East Livingston. Be with us, Master, as we make decisions for our future. Be with Greg Roth, Master, as you prepare his heart for ministry in this specific church. We pray, Lord, that he has a heart for this community. We pray that we also have a heart to support him Thank you, Master, for the work of the committee. Pat, Fred, Nardine, Emma, Linda, Peg, and Marie. Thank you so much, Master, for their efforts. Laura, thank you for working with them. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for being with them as they work together to find our next leader. And finally, Lord, for this country, that this country would turn, Lord, to you if it truly wants to receive those blessings of God. Help us, Lord, as a country to learn from the mistakes of ancient Israel. And let us serve you as a nation. We pray, Lord, we want your will to be done, Lord. We want your glory to be known throughout the earth, throughout America, throughout all the countries of the world. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Several of us have met on Wednesday evenings before the COVID situation hit us in order to study the book of Exodus. The opening comment that I want to make comes out actually of the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 6. It is a summary of what Moses had learned through all of what had gone before. It essentially is his last word and testament, this great speech, which it takes up essentially the entire book of Deuteronomy. Chapter 6, the first 9 verses in particular, are the best summary that exists of what Moses had to say was most important. And I invite you simply to listen to it as I read it, to follow along in your own Bible if you're able to do that. So this is what Moses is saying as personally as he can get to a crowd of 2 million people. These are the commands, decrees, and laws Yahweh your God directed me to teach you to observe in the land that you are crossing the Jordan to possess, so that you, your children, and their children after them may fear Yahweh your God as long as you live by keeping all his decrees and commands that I give you, and so that you may enjoy long life. Hear, Israel, and be careful to obey so that it may go well with you and that you may increase greatly in a land flowing with milk and honey, just as Yahweh, the God of your ancestors, promised you. Hear, O Israel, Yahweh, our God, Yahweh is one. Love Yahweh, your God, with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your strength. These commands that I give you today are to be on your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road and when you lie down and when you get up. Tie them as symbols on your hands and bind them on your foreheads. Write them on the door frames of your houses and on your gates. Really quite a statement. Very good, best summary that Moses can offer to us. Have you ever thought that is probably the most famous part of the first 5 books of the Bible? It has been emphasized for generations as the best of the summaries. How well has it been carried out? And unfortunately, what you have is the story of a people who will say repeatedly, this is what binds us together. but we really are free to ignore it. I'm not talking specifically about Jewish people or any group in particular. That is something that hits Christians, I'm afraid, perhaps some of us, very carefully, very fully. How well did the leaders and the people do this? They failed. And I'd like to have you see some of the results of that failure by opening now to Psalm 78. Psalm 78. You'll notice that at the very beginning, the heading has to do with Asaph. Kind of interesting, who is this guy? And the truth that makes it more confusing is there are multiple Asaphs identified in Scripture. The very first Asaph was a part of the staff that David assembled. The particular Asaph that is mentioned in this heading, however, lived during the time after Israel, after Judah had been taken into Babylonian captivity, but before they were released by the Persian emperor to go back to Jerusalem. That man and the people he represents are wondering, why in the world is this taking so long? It seems like God has been defeated by the God of the Babylonians. It seems like if that wasn't the case, that our God should have rescued us by now, and we really just don't get it. Now, I'd like to read for you the first 8 verses, because this is actually the second longest psalm in the Bible. Unless you want to be here for a very long time, we won't be doing a whole lot of detailing of it. But those first 8 verses are this tinting that I've been talking about for several months now. Whenever you look at a psalm, the best way to understand it is that if you can capture the idea or ideas that are most prominent in the earliest of verses, those ideas will carry through and be prominent in the rest of what is said throughout the psalm. And that is true in most of the books of the Bible, but especially in the Psalms, we can apply it very easily. So let me read for you how Asaph looks at what has happened. He is going to, like Moses, give a declaration. But then I want you to notice when we get to verse 8 that something kind of ugly happens, because he has to, instead of just watching what he wants to call the good idea, he suddenly has to handle reality. My people, hear my teaching. Listen to the words of my mouth. I will open my mouth with a parable. I will utter hidden things, things from of old, things we have heard and known, things our ancestors have told us. We will not hide them from their descendants. We will tell the next generation. In other words, all that material that I just read from Deuteronomy 6, we're going to be found faithful to it. The praiseworthy deeds of Yahweh, his power and the wonders he has done. He decreed statutes for Jacob and established the law in Israel, which he commanded our ancestors to teach their children, so the next generation would know them, even the children yet to be born, and they in turn would tell their children, and then they would put their trust in God and would not forget his deeds, but would keep his commands. And that's the theory, isn't it? But he's got to handle reality. They would not be like their ancestors, a stubborn and rebellious generation whose hearts were not loyal to God, whose spirits were not loyal
faithful to him.
So something has gone badly wrong. Now, at home sometime, you may want to read the whole psalm, but let me give you the basic idea of it. There is very quickly, starting in verse 9, the mention of Ephraim, one of the 12 tribes of Israel. He is a very important part of the whole tribal system. You see, back when Israel was starting to be formed, Jacob had children. And Jacob's children, the sons at least, 12 of them, picked on Joseph, one of the 12, and sent him off to Egypt, and they totally misused him. They told Jacob, your boy is dead. And he was just lost to the family for a significant period of time. In time, of course, Joseph became the second in command over all of Egypt, and he could save his family. Remarkable. And that made Joseph the big shot of the tribes, all of them. And he was rewarded by, in effect, having a double heritage. Two sons, Ephraim and Manasseh. And both of them were blessed by grandfather when Grandpa Jacob was dying. Ephraim became very prominent along the way. And interestingly, the man who followed Moses as the leader of the Hebrews, Joshua, was from Ephraim. And the place of the holy Ark of the Covenant was in Shiloh. You would be right if you guessed where it was located, in Ephraim. Because you see, those are some of the pieces of the heritage that had been passed along to them. Unfortunately, even though they were to enjoy their blessings under Yahweh, they forgot that part of it. And their priority became looking good in the eyes of the rest of the tribes. And that's an overstatement, but there's some very real truth in it. They just didn't care about the Lord anymore. And after generations where Deuteronomy 6 was not carried out, the Lord said, enough already. And so you have the story of David coming into prominence. He is from Judah, not from Ephraim. God had made a promise, but it was not just a promise, it was a covenant. And that's different than a promise. If I promise I'm going to take my kids to King's Island sometime this summer, in theory, it doesn't matter if they sass their mom or not. I've just said I'm going to do this. A covenant isn't constructed that way. A covenant is constructed, you do this, and I do that. Well, that's the opposite of, in some ways, how we understand covenant. And there are some problems with the way I'm saying it, I know. But a covenant requires obedience. And Ephraim had failed. So they lost their leadership role. Manasseh also lost its leadership role. And all of that responsibility rolled into Judah and the house of David. Now, one of the difficulties is in all of this psalm is that Asaph is standing in front of this congregation, leading worship now. No longer even is the priestly role or the location of the sanctuary in the tribe of Ephraim. It's all been transferred to David because David is a man after God's own heart. But the problem is that Asaph is standing in front of leading people who are now prisoners of Babylon in worship. And their heritage comes up for the same kind of difficulty that Ephraim had faced. You see, something that's very important for us to remember is that God may choose to use people, and then because of the unfaithfulness of that people, may move away from using them. Did it happen with Ephraim? They were on the verge of it happening with the descendants of David. Now, along the way, of course, there was this auxiliary promise through David, this covenant that comes, that there would be another, the Messiah. And the Messiah would bring the whole of the 12 tribes back to himself and beyond that to himself. But Psalm 78 is something of a warning. We must be faithful or the Lord will replace us. Hard to say. By being here this morning, you and I are identifying as American Baptists, as a gathering of people over decades who have chosen to affiliate under that title. And we are therefore in what is called the mainline church of America. How is that church doing today? I'm afraid that the answer that we have to give is it's almost like we're on the verge of being replaced. I mean, I'm trying to be as honest with you as I can be. And the reason for that, I think, is exactly what you see in Psalm 78. When a people, a movement, we're talking about a lot of people now, when those people have failed over generations to be faithful to the call, then the Lord says, I'm going to pick someone who will be faithful to the call. In another week, we will have worship. And when we have that worship, we'll complete it in the normal way, and then we will have a meeting, which I'm assuming Nordine will lead, and Fred will lead, and others as well. And in that meeting, just as Nordine mentioned this morning, we are going to be talking together about, do we want to proceed toward asking a particular candidate to fill that role and be considered for us together. Now, part of what's going on here has to do with the issue of, can he come as a part-time person at the beginning and make a living in another way to supplement his income for himself and his family? But that's not the only issue that you're going to have to face. Because he has said, you tell me that you want to grow. You tell me that you have a set of values. Do you? Are you willing to commit yourself to this set of values? And I have asked Pat this morning specifically, in the coming week, to get him to say specifically, these are the set of values, these are the behaviors that I believe would be important if I am to come to this church. Now, Pat is going, yes, and if I'm not, Pat, at any time, you can correct me. But we have that issue to come up with, an answer. Are we willing to do this and that? And my sense is when we know specifically what this and that involve, we will be able to make an appropriate choice along the way. But you see, today is a communion Sunday. It is a time when a lot of things will feel different when we do this, because there's not a whole lot of us here this morning. But it's a time when effectively we look at the covenant that God has laid before us. These are symbols of the dying and the resurrection of Jesus. And it's a perfectly valid time to say, I want to, or I don't want to, recommit to these values with this people. If we say, I don't care to commit, then we may very well be in the whole stream of what you see in Psalm 78. Now, it may be that he asks for something that we don't think is practical or useful or right biblically, and you have the right to respond in the way that is the most honest to you. But I want to say to you, we are Baptists, and that comes historically with a whole set of values. We call it individual soul competency. And so, as a Baptist, I am bound by that history to say to you, while we have to agree on the basics or we don't have any reason to be together, I have to give you the right to a different set of understandings of what God calls us to do. And we very typically will grab that part and forget the second part. And the second part is, and with those rights of being able to stand directly before God, we have the responsibilities of standing directly before God. And we have a need this morning, I think, to say individually in our hearts, this is in fact where we stand. Not simply because we could really lose a lot if we don't honestly stand here, but because how many times, especially as I read from Deuteronomy 6, did you hear the promise, so it will go well with you, so you will have a long life. In other words, so you'll be glad you did it. There is all of that that's at stake in any choice that we're making together. So, in just a moment, I invite the ushers to come forward and to do a modified version of what we're used to. I'm going to be asking us, each in our own hearts, to say to the Lord, I know that I need to be on the same page with you. There are some parts of this that I get. I know what that means. I may make an adjustment here or there. There are other parts I don't even know what we're talking about. So, Lord, I want you to fill in the blanks where I have blanks. But you see, what I'm asking is a commitment to be whatever it is that the Lord wants. And that will give us the standing so that when we're together on the 12th after worship, we already have that part settled. And we can listen through that filter to what Nordine and Fred and others tell us about what our prospective new pastor is requesting of us. We'll be able to do it well. I think that's worth doing. Let me give you, as a concluding word before we do the communion, a passage that is just magnificent. It's from Colossians chapter 1, It begins in verse 9, and it tells me and you and any other believer the extent of the commitment to our best that God intends for us. Isn't that always nice to hear? Let me share it with you, and you can follow along. Again, Colossians 1, starting in verse 9, we'll read through verse 14. For this reason, since the day we heard about you, we have not stopped praying for you. We continually ask God to fill you with the knowledge of His will through all the wisdom and understanding that the Spirit gives. Yeah, Eric did, in fact, you're right. He included that in prayer this morning. So that you may live a life worthy of the Lord and praise Him in every way, bearing fruit in every good work, growing in the knowledge of God, being strengthened with all power according to His glorious might, so that you may have great endurance and patience, and giving joyful thanks to the Father who has qualified you to share in the inheritance of His holy people in the kingdom of light. Can I have an amen for that? Yeah, amen. For He has rescued us from the dominion of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of the Son He loves, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. All of that is ours. And all I'm asking, all I'm suggesting, is that we understand it is covenant dependent. And we have a need to ensure that we're inside of that covenant so that we can participate in something that is that beautiful. Well, would you bow with me in a moment of prayer? Lord, on this July 4th weekend, while the world is celebrating a memory of independence, we are celebrating and being held to a standard of depending on you to define our lives and to make our lives worthwhile. And I know we'll enjoy all of the stuff of the season insofar as we're able to, and we'll be very proud of our nation, all that goes with it. But in the midst of that, we take the time to say, what a package you have arranged for us. Oh, we glorify you. Oh, we say thank you. Oh, we recognize that without you, there would be no package. There would be no independence. There would be no, and we can fill in a whole lot of blanks there. Thank you for the love that was so intense that Jesus would seal it with His death and then demonstrate its value in His resurrection, and then say, and I'm sharing mine with you. Thank you for all of that in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, Dexter and Pat, would you please come forward, and we'll be preparing to share our communion. You'll notice that I'm not going to pass the dishes to them. They will do that themselves. When we have completed our time together, you will obviously have a cup. And you will also have a little, paper cup that held your bread. In order that we don't ask anyone else to take care of your stuff and any germs that you may have, when we come out at the end of the service, I'm going to ask that we march forward, that we go around as we have done. You can put your offering in the box. You know that pattern. And then right next to it today is a wastebasket. So put your own leftovers from communion in that. One other piece that is going to be important for us. When we have finished together doing communion, I will ask that we stand, but do not move to take hands. And we will sing the normal Blessed Be the Tie in a way that is appropriate and safe for all of us. Dexter, I'm going to ask you to lead in prayer. You'll notice I'm not passing him a mic. And the reason for that is the same thing that for all of the rest of this. So Dexter, pray loud if you would.
Our Lord and our God, we thank you, we bless you, and we honor you. We thank you, Lord, because in times of trials and temptation, in difficult times, that's beyond our understanding, beyond our reach, you got a possibility, God of greatness, supersede on behalf of us. We thank you this hour, O Lord, for guiding us together in your sanctuary to worship you with truth and holiness, to bless your name and honor you and adore you. Lift your name above all names. Father, we say thank you. We ask, Lord, as we are about to partake in this, the body of your Son, Lord, we pray that all sickness, heal our broken wound, heal our trials and temptation, hurt everything that's unbelievable, that threatens our lives as individuals. You know our trouble is. Let us come in, heal us. Let the blood, let the body restore good health to us and make us stronger again as we come to worship you in truth and holiness. In Jesus' name I pray.
Amen. The Lord Jesus, on the night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, broken for you. Please distribute the elements." We have one remaining symbol showing us the value of the blood of the Lord. As we anticipate sharing that symbol, would you lead us in prayer?
Heavenly Father, we're so grateful in our heart and thankful fact that you died for us and you shed your blood for us that we might be made clean and righteous before the throne of God. And I pray, Lord, for our congregation and ask you, Lord, that you come mightily to be with us at this time and that we not get discouraged, but we trust in you completely for each and every moment that we are to face ahead, and that we as a congregation would give you the glory, and that we would truly love one another, our neighbors, and all those out there that you have given us to find for your glory and for your kingdom. Thank you, God. Just thank you, God, for all that you do for us every day and how you keep us strong walking through this world. In Jesus' name.
In the same way, after supper, he took the cup. And when he had done that, when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, all of you, drink this. This cup is my blood of the new covenant, shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Dexter, Pat, would you please share the symbol of blood of Jesus? Jesus Christ shed for the forgiveness of our sins. We share it together in remembrance of him. Did you notice something rather unique and strong about that statement in Deuteronomy 6? It requires spending virtually all of ourselves so that our families get the message. And the idea, of course, is that in that process, our nation gets the message. And in a very real way, the story of the faith is not simply that a really bad leader came along and messed everything up. No, the story of the faith is that those generations, those individual families, who had the responsibility of shaping those leaders, let something pass. I would assume that in a church that has said to a possibly incoming pastor, we want to grow, that one of the things that he is going to ask of us is a willingness to share the commitment to tell the story, that it can't stop with us. Be thinking very seriously as we anticipate this coming week and what's going to happen in a week about whether we're willing to do that, to take the extreme measures that are summarized in Deuteronomy 6 and say those should be normal for us. We need to be defined by our obedience to them. It's going to be a very important week. So a part of the commitment that I ask of each one of us is to make the choices about, are we willing to go with what God is telling us in terms of the covenant? I'm asking that our commitment include each day of this week, starting today right through. Lord, we're going to be together. Have us ready as a body to follow you perfectly. In some ways, I suppose, I'm making this up, but in some ways, it seems like we will know before Pastor Roth arrives whether we're going to support him and his family. Because we will have been in regular communication about this matter for a period of time. Not only between now and next week, but a good, it's got to be at least 2 or 3 weeks of notice of telling the rest of the congregation, this candidating is going to happen. This will determine our future. And as we're faithful along those ways, we may very well get messages before we meet the man. I wouldn't be very surprised. This is your church. It's not mine. It's not ABC Ohio. It's your church. And I am asking you to act like those responsible for it, so that it is formed in such a way that it reflects the work that God has done in our midst. All of that is important. Having said that, I invite us to stand together as we sing our familiar first verse of Blessed Be the Time. And Rick, please lead us. The people who are cleaning up for us will not be required to touch them. May God bless us as we go.